Good morning and welcome to First Church of Christ at Home. We're so glad you're watching today. My name is David Hall. I'm the pastor here at First Church, and it's so good to be with you. Today's service is meant to be interactive, so go ahead and take a minute right now to say hi in the online chat there. Tell us your name, how many are worshiping with you. That's a big help to us, and it's such an encouragement. We want to know who's joining us online each week. Also, if you would, please take a moment to fill out the digital connect card by clicking on the appropriate tab or link. And if you have any specific prayer needs that you would like to share, there's a link for you to submit those as well. We would just count it an honor to pray for you throughout this week. This morning, we're going to be continuing our sermon series, Be Ready for Jesus. In just a little bit, I'll be sharing message number 3, entitled Be Aert for the Antichrist. I really believe the Lord is going to speak to your heart and encourage you today. I also want to say a big thank you to everyone who gives to support the ministry and mission here at First Church. You make it possible for the gospel message to continue to go out. Okay, are you ready to worship? Let's do it.
Just one word. You calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Oh, just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes are open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Just one word, You heal what's broken inside. Just one word, and You revive every dream. Just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. Oh, just one touch, my eyes are open to see. My heart can't help but believe.
There's no power like the power of Jesus. So let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Sing it.
I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power. Yeah. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like His power. There's nothing that our God can do.
I give you glory for all you brought me through. And now I'm ready for whatever you wanna do. I'm moving forward to follow after you. And now I'm ready for whatever you wanna do.
People with perfect pitch flinch when they hear something just a little off key. A perfectionist about appearance will let every stray hair or even a single wrinkle make him or her feel uncomfortable. A skilled woodworker creating an intricate inlaid pattern on a tabletop will not tolerate even one misaligned piece. The crew of a NASA flight sent to the moon would be very put off if there were the slightest miscalculation in their trajectory. I mean, that would mean sending them into outer space with no hope of return. If I were preparing a 3-egg omelet for dinner, you know, I might think that one rotten egg out of three, well, that's okay. I mean, after all, 2 out of 3 ain't bad. Well, I'm afraid my wife wouldn't find it so acceptable. And yet, that's what we do with God. We bring Him a life that is only a little bit out of tune, only slightly off course, only a little rotten, and we expect Him to accept it. We humans tend to tolerate imperfection in the lives of others because that's all we ever get. We don't expect people to be perfect. I mean, we'd have no fellowship at all if we insisted that everybody qualify by a life of perfection. But when it comes to being right with God, perfection is required. Revelation 21 describes heaven, and verse 27 says very clearly that nothing unclean will be there. Perfection is required. So what are we to do? If anyone faced this problem, the Christians in Corinth did. Of all the churches seen in the New Testament, the Corinthian church seemed to have more than its share of serious sinners. In chapter 6 of 1 Corinthians, Paul acknowledges this. He lists some serious, deadly sins that they were guilty of, saying that those who do these things would not inherit the kingdom of God. But then he adds in verse 11, "And some of you were once like that, but you were cleansed. You were made holy. You were made right with God by calling on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God." Here at this table, we stand as imperfect, unclean people, made perfect and clean in Christ. Paul put it this way in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, "For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin, so that we could be made right with God through Christ. For this reason, we remember Him who in the upper room said, 'This is my body given for you, and this is my blood shed for you. In Him is our righteousness.'"
Show us. major cities virtually shut down. That street normally packed with tourists, now empty as well.
The Federal Reserve, the nation's central bank.
Experts say if that happens, call your doctor.
I'm feeling pretty bad. I think this is probably the worst cold I've ever had.
The outbreak is spreading. The pandemic has now infected every part of American life, from home to work and everywhere in between.
America has changed for now. There's no question about that.
We will see more cases, and things will get worse than they are right now.
Coronavirus, COVID-19. All that is happening in our world. You know, the Bible tells us that there are signs of the times we should be looking for. Are these things pointing to the imminent return of Jesus?
Satan came to Eve in the Garden of Eden with the express purpose of deceiving her. He whispered to her, "Has God said you're not to eat of any tree in the garden? If you eat of that tree, you'll not die the way that God says. If you eat of that tree, you'll really live. You'll be as God himself. You'll be free," he says. And sadly, both Adam and Eve listened to Satan's lies and were cast out of the garden. And they discovered that Satan was a deceiver and that God's word was true. And from that time on, Satan has been active in our world, trying to deceive people to persuade them not to listen to the word of God. He sometimes attacks our bodies through suffering the way he did Job. He sometimes attacks the will by appealing to our pride the way he attempted to do with Jesus. But most often, Satan attacks the mind with lies, the way that he did Eve, because he knows that the battle for the soul is primarily won or lost in our thinking. That's why 2 Corinthians, the second chapter, verse 11, warns us not to let Satan outwit us, for we are not unaware of his schemes. And if we're going to withstand the spiritual pressures of the last days, we have got to be mentally alert. Now, we've been studying the second coming of Jesus the last couple of weeks as it's revealed to us in the book of 2 Thessalonians. And here in the second chapter, we have an important section if we're going to be ready for the coming of the Christ. The promise of the Lord's return motivates us to holiness, to intensity, and to hope. And so the nearer we come to that event, the more we can anticipate Satan's aggressive opposition to it. And so today, I want us to note the three ways that Satan is working against the return of Christ. I want you to notice, first of all, that Satan promotes alarming prophecies. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 and 2 read, "Concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered to him, we ask you, brothers, not to become easily unsettled or alarmed by some prophecy, report, or letter supposed to have come from us, saying that the day of the Lord has already come." Now, the Thessalonians were being disturbed by people who said that Jesus returned and you missed him. Satan has always delighted in alarming people with unsettling prophecies. I mean, you go to the average Christian bookstore today and just look at all the titles of the books in the prophecy section. I mean, they're oftentimes so sensational that they sound like the headlines from the tabloids. Babylon rebuilt, or the Ark of the Covenant discovered, or vultures gathering in Israel, computer beast in Belgium, the mark of the beast is here, and on they go. Or listen to some of the media evangelists, and you'll hear wild rumors. You know, the Social Security Administration has plans to stamp invisible numbers on the backs of the hands of people. Building blocks for the next Jewish temple have already been cut and numbered, and the blocks are stored in abandoned Kmart buildings all across the U.S. Or Jane Fonda's name has the numerical equivalent of 666, the mystical number of the Antichrist. Or Rush Limbaugh is the beast with six horns coming out of the sea, or something ridiculous like that. Bizarre rumors like that circulate among prophecy buffs. Some people just naively plug into it and are alarmed and unsettled, thinking that the rapture is going to occur next week. And they can't think about anything else. I mean, they're so heavenly minded that they're of no earthly good. But the result is that people react against that, and the pendulum swings all the way to the opposite direction. And instead of being alarmed, some Christians get apathetic, thinking people conclude that the whole field of Bible prophecy is nothing but a playground for fanatics, and so they just dismiss it altogether. Some people say, well, you know, I know that Jesus is going to return someday, but I'm not going to be all that concerned about it, because he said nobody knows the day or the hour. The Bible says he's going to come like a thief in the night, and so I'm not going to be concerned about it. But prophecy was given not to alarm us or to make us apathetic. It was given to keep us alert. You know, no one knows the day or the hour, but we ought to be aware of the season of the Lord's return. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 4, the Bible says, "But you, brothers, are not in darkness, so that this day should surprise you like a thief. So then, let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be alert and self-controlled." Now, there are a number of signs of Christ's return that ought to keep us alert today. Things like upheavals in nature. You know, the Bible talks about the beginning of birth pangs being famines and earthquakes. And we have things like floods and natural disasters increasing. There's an increase of wickedness. There's the spread of the gospel through the whole world via radio and television and internet. But to me, one of the most impressive fulfillments of Bible prophecy in history is occurring in our day, and that is the regathering of the Jews in Israel. In 70 AD, Jerusalem was destroyed, and the Jewish people were dispersed all throughout the entire world. And people scoffed when students of the Bible said that, you know, when they would say that one day the Jewish population would be returned to Palestine and become a nation again. Impossible, people would say. But in 1948, Israel was restored as a nation. And since that time, millions of Jews have returned to their homeland, just as the Bible predicted. Listen to this passage from the book of Amos, the 9th chapter, verses 14 and 15 that read, "I will bring back my exiled people to Israel, and they will rebuild the ruined cities and live in them. I will plant Israel in their own land, never again to be uprooted from the land I have given them, says the Lord your God." Now, the Jews have not only returned to Palestine in our generation, but they have reoccupied Jerusalem. Remember in Luke chapter 21, verse 24, that Jesus predicted Jerusalem will be trampled on by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. Now, from 70 AD until 1967, Jerusalem has been occupied by Gentiles. The Romans were followed by the Byzantines, the Arabs, the Crusaders, the Mamluks, the Turks, the British, and then the Jordanians. But in the Six-Day War of June 1967, the Jews recaptured Jerusalem for the first time in 1,897 years. Rabbi Shlomo Goren, the chief rabbi of the Israeli army in 1967, rushed to the Wailing Wall, and he blew a shofar, and he solemnly proclaimed the beginning of the Messianic Age. A couple of years ago, Time magazine had a feature article in the religious section entitled, "Time for a New Temple." And the article read in part, "Traditionalist Jews hope to rebuild their sacred edifice, but a mosque and centuries of enmity stand in the way." And they had a picture of the model of the proposed temple in Jerusalem. And the article said, "Jerusalem's Temple Mount potentially is the most volatile 35 acres on the face of the earth." You see, now Israel has become the focal point of world politics. Ever since the Arab oil boat boycott back in 1973, the Middle East is the focal point of much of the news. Many in the West have realized the dependence on Arab oil, and many have lined up with the Arab obsession to annihilate Israel. But listen to Zechariah chapter 12, verse 3. It says in Zechariah 12, 3, that on that day, when all the nations of the earth are gathered against her, I will make Jerusalem an immovable rock for all of the nations, and all who try to move it will injure themselves. Now, with all of these prophecies being fulfilled, Christians should sense that we are living in the season of the Lord's return. Jesus said, you're able to tell the weather. I mean, you look at the sky at night, and if it's red, you say, it's going to be a nice day tomorrow. Or you look at the sky in the morning, and if it's red and overcast, you say, well, it's going to rain today. Why is it, Jesus said, that you're able to discern the signs of the weather, but you can't discern the signs of the times? And just as birds instinctively fly south when winter is coming, so Christians filled with the Holy Spirit of God and knowledgeable about the Bible ought to just instinctively sense that we are in the season of the Lord's return. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25 reads, encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. And so we shouldn't be alarmed, but neither should we be apathetic. We ought to be alert. But the second way that Satan works to counter the return of Jesus Christ is that he exalts himself as God. Look at verse 3 of our text this morning, where we see Satan himself setting himself up as a counterfeit Messiah. 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 3 reads, don't let anyone deceive you in any way. For that day will not come until the rebellion occurs and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the man doomed to destruction. Now, there are two very legitimate ways to interpret this passage. One is to interpret it figuratively and say that the man of lawlessness simply means that there's going to be a spirit of rebellion permeate the whole world before Jesus comes back. Some of the predictions about Jesus' first coming were figurative, like that he would reign from the throne of David. Well, he didn't literally sit on the throne of David. It was a spiritual reign. The other way to interpret this passage is the way that I'm going to interpret it, and that is to interpret it literally. That there is going to be a man, a world ruler, who is the Antichrist. Many of the prophecies about Christ's first coming were literal. Prophecies such as that he would be born in Bethlehem, that he would be born of a virgin. St. Augustine once said in regard to this particular passage, he says, I admit the meaning of this completely escapes me. Now, if Augustine, who was a great theologian, didn't understand it, I doubt that I'm going to be a whole lot of help to you either. But you know, fools rush in where wise men dare to tread, and so let's give it a try. Folks, admittedly, this is a heavier passage than I would normally like to deal with in a Sunday morning message. But I'm committed to preaching to you the whole counsel of God, trying to deal with all the subjects that are covered in Scripture. And so try to stay with me this morning as we look through this difficult passage. You know, I think Scripture indicates that Satan is going to manifest himself as a diabolical world ruler. In Daniel chapter 9, he's called the ruler who is to come. In Revelation chapter 13, he's called the beast who is to come up out of the sea. In 1 John chapter 4, he's called the Antichrist who is coming. And here in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, he is called the lawless one. Verse 4 says, he will oppose and will exalt himself over everything that is called God or is worshipped, so that he sets himself up in God's temple, proclaiming himself to be God. Back when I was a teenager, some Christian people persuaded some Hollywood producers to make a movie about the coming Antichrist. And they projected that it would be he would be a child of Satan. And this movie vastly sensationalized the story, but it was released on the sixth day of the sixth month in the year 1976. It was a big hit in the box office. You may know the movie. It was called The Omen. And the fact that it, in the very first week, grossed more than any other movie in history up until that point, to me indicated the interest the American people have in the coming world ruler. You know, the scripture hints that the Antichrist is going to appear in a very chaotic time in history, that he'll pretend to be an ambassador of peace. But people will be so hungry for a charismatic leader who can restore order to the world and stabilize the world economy that they'll just get sucked in. You know, people tend to be very fickle, and a president or a leader can be riding a high on the wave of popularity one day and then seemingly overnight just be cast aside by those very same people as they scramble, to follow after a new leader. Now, the Antichrist is going to come establishing a new world order. Already we're seeing that nationalistic pride is passé. We're paving the way for a one world government, a one world religion, a one world economy, which will facilitate the Antichrist's rise to power. Revelation chapter 13, verse 7 says, "He was given authority over every tribe, people, language, and nation." And verse 16 says, "He also forced everyone to receive a mark on his right hand or on his forehead so that no one could buy or sell unless he had the mark." And the Antichrist will establish this worldwide economic system, a monetary system that will be mandatory. And when he reaches the zenith of his popularity, he sets himself up in God's temple. He desecrates the temple. He claims that he is the Messiah, then that he is to be worshipped. Then the majority of knowledgeable Jews will reject him, and the Antichrist turns on them, and he persecutes the Jews on an unprecedented scale. And instead of bringing peace, he brings chaos and disorder. In Matthew chapter 24, verse 21, Jesus says, "For then there will be great distress, unequaled from the beginning of the world until now, and never to be equaled again." In 70 AD, as many as 1 million Jews were killed when Titus overthrew Jerusalem. And then in the 1940s, 6 million Jews were exterminated in the Holocaust. But Jesus said there is going to come a time of persecution that will be even worse than those. In fact, Zechariah chapter 13, verses 8 and 9 say that during that period, during the end times, that two-thirds of the Jewish people will die during a period of unparalleled calamity. But look at verse 7 of our text today. It says that right now the Antichrist is restrained from taking power. Verse 7 says, "The secret power of lawlessness is already at work, but the one who now holds it back will continue to do so until he is taken out of the way." Now, what is restraining the power of lawlessness right now? Well, I can only think of one force that is greater than the power of Satan, and that is the power of the Holy Spirit living in Christians. The Bible says, "Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world." And so the Holy Spirit living in the hearts of Christian people is suppressing the work of Satan to a degree today. But when the Holy Spirit is taken out of the world, the Antichrist will have free reign. Now, how will the Holy Spirit be taken out of the way? Well, I believe that Christians are going to be raptured out of this world. The next event that we're told to look for in Scripture is not the coming of the Antichrist, but the coming of Jesus. Back in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16, it says, "For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air." Christians one day are mysteriously going to disappear. And maybe those left behind will think that we've been taken away by alien forces or that there's some strange virus that has taken us away. But think about that. What hole it would leave in Cherokee, Iowa, if 100 or so Christians from the First Church of Christ were taken up to be with the Lord. You'd come to church on Sunday and just a handful of people would be here. Some would get their wish, you know. That sermon that first Sunday would be the shortest sermon that they had ever heard. But when Christians are taken out of the world someday, it's going to leave a tremendous spiritual and moral vacuum. Satan and the world will be relieved to have those puritanical Christians with all of their oppressive rules gone and out of the way. Verse 8 says, "Then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will overthrow with the breath of his mouth and destroy by the splendor of his coming." The coming of the lawless one will be in accordance with the work of Satan displayed in all kinds of counterfeit miracles, signs, and wonders, and in every sort of evil that deceives those who are perishing. So the Antichrist has three basic appeals. First, he promises peace in a time of chaos. Secondly, he has supernatural powers that really intrigue people. Now, they're limited powers, but there is some supernatural power nonetheless. And then thirdly, no rules. He deceives people in all kinds of evil. Everything is permissible. But verse 3 says the Antichrist is doomed to destruction. Verse 8 says that the Lord is going to overthrow him, how? With the breath of his mouth when he comes. And so the reign of the Antichrist is going to be pretty brief. You know, most students of Bible prophecy believe it's only going to be 7 years, called in the Bible the period of the Great Tribulation. And then Jesus Christ comes back with the Christians in power, in glory, and he blows Satan away in a spiritual battle called the Battle of Armageddon that lasts really just seconds. And Jesus Christ then reigns as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Dr. Fisher Humphreys was a professor at New Orleans Seminary who prided himself in being an excellent chess player. But when he was at Oxford, he had a chance to compete against the European national champion in a game of chess. And the European champion was playing 30 people at the same time. And Dr. Humphreys was devastated when he was beaten in just 14 moves. And he said to the champion, "I can't believe it. You beat me in just 14 moves. I've never seen anything like it in my life." And the champion smiled at him and said, "No, sir, I beat you in 5 moves. It just took you 9 more to find it out." Well, Satan has already been defeated by Jesus Christ at the cross and at the empty tomb. And it's going to be made crystal clear to him when Jesus one day overthrows him with just the breath of his mouth and destroys him at the splendor of his coming. And then the third way that Satan counters Christ is the most relevant to us today, really. And that is that he counters Christ by suppressing the truth. Verse 10 of our text reads, "They perish because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved. For this reason, God sends them a powerful delusion so that they will believe the lie and so that all will be condemned who have not believed the truth but have delighted in wickedness." Our salvation is not dependent upon what we believe about the Antichrist. In fact, you can disagree with almost everything I've said in this sermon up to this point, and that's okay. You're still a Christian. You're still saved. Our salvation is determined, however, by what we believe about Jesus Christ. We believe Jesus Christ is the only begotten Son of God. We believe that He died an atoning death for our sins and that He arose from the dead to prove that He is God in the flesh. We believe that we are saved by making Him our personal Savior and Lord and by confessing Him and being baptized into Him. We believe that He is the source of truth. He said in John chapter 14, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Now, Satan is doing everything within his power in these days to subvert that truth. He'll come along and he'll whisper, "You're not created. You're not a created being with a purpose. You're simply a cosmic accident of evolution." Or he'll come along and he'll say, "Jesus isn't the unique Son of God any more than Gandhi or Muhammad are. He's just a good teacher." And Satan spreads the lie that you aren't saved by trusting Jesus as God, but that you are your own God and that you have unlimited potential on your own. And there is no absolute truth, he'll say. It's just all relative. Right and wrong, they're determined by individuals and not by Jesus Christ. Therefore, you're completely free to live as you please. And having rejected the truth, God gives them over, and people believe the wildest lies. I mean, it's incredible what people are believing today. We have people going after astrology and numerology and Satanism and transcendental meditation and channeling and crystal gazing and psychic hotlines. Dr. Albert Mohler, president of Southern Baptist Theological Seminary, said that there are 3 million Americans today who believe that they have been abducted by UFOs. Folks, these are people who are driving cars out there and coming your direction. But having dismissed the truth, people don't believe nothing. They believe anything. And they get sucked into the wildest fantasies. God sends them this powerful delusion so that they will believe the lie, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 11 says. Dave Stone, recently retired preacher of Southeast Christian Church, one of the largest churches in our country and in our brotherhood of churches, agreed to do an interview with a reporter from CBS News in New York leading up to the recent presidential election. They were preparing this hour-long documentary on the religious right. And the reporter was not a believer. And for about 45 minutes, he just kept tossing question after question to Dave about whose values. How do we know there's no absolute truth? How can this work for everybody? And when Dave would come back with the simple basics and say, "Well, let me tell you what we believe. We believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God who died for our sins. And we believe that He arose from the dead to show that He's God in the flesh. And we believe that He is the source of absolute truth and that one day we're all going to be accountable to Him." You know, when Dave started talking about those things, you could just see that the reporter was disinterested. And he would just start thumbing through his notes, looking for the next question to ask. And Dave said that he was reminded of Alan Bloom's statement in his book, The Closing of the American Mind. Bloom said this. He said, "Relativism has not opened up our minds to new truths. It has closed our minds to old ones." And there are two basic reasons that people disbelieve the simple truth. One of them is pride. It's so humbling to accept the simple revealed truth from God rather than intellectually getting it on your own. And then the second reason that people reject it is evil desires. People don't want to believe if it means that they have to change their behavior. But Paul teaches here that a person can resist the truth so long that eventually he becomes hardened to it. But Christians, you and I, We are to be distinctive. We are to resist the lies of Satan, and we are to love the truth and be saved by it. Verse 13 says, God chose you to be saved through the sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit and through belief in the truth. The Bible says in John chapter 8, then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. When Columbus was sailing to America, his men became panicky after so many weeks of uncharted seas that they began plotting a mutiny against Columbus to force him to turn back. And while those plans were developing, somebody spotted some debris floating on the ocean coming from the west. And that could only mean one thing, that they were approaching land. And so they dropped the plans of mutiny and they sailed west with hope. Well, Satan is right now mounting a mutiny against God, saying there is no God, there is no life after death, there is no hope. Now, God in every generation has sent some signs of the coming of Christ so that people don't lose hope. And maybe it's just because the world is so pressure-packed and so full of wickedness today that these signs seem to be increasing in intensity. And maybe the Lord is not going to come back in our generation. But you know what? I rather think that He will. But the important thing is that we be alert, that we be found believing in and living in the truth. Somebody has said we ought to live every day as though Jesus died yesterday, He arose from the dead today, and He's coming back tomorrow. And who knows? Maybe He will.
I am tethered to Your every word, my heart ever after Your heart first. I will trust You here. I will trust You here. Said in who You are, even when I can't see every part, I will trust You here. I will trust You. I won't forget the things You've done, for I know that this is just the beginning. See Your promise come, God, with all I am, I'll keep believing that You're not finished yet. You're not finished yet. You don't play games. It's not who You are. You're not the type to mislead my heart. I can trust You here. Oh, I can trust You here. And now I've only known You to keep Your word. I've only found love at every turn.
Yeah. upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn